So good afternoon. This is WTOK, Radio Whiteside, broadcasting from my studio in my backyard, which is to say a chair set up in the middle of my backyard. And so what we're going to do is something a little bit different. I am going to sort of do a cross-channel radio show and a podcast of sorts, I guess, and walk you through the rise of postmodern music. I choose music because it's what I know best, more or less. I think it's easily accessible. You can, you know, digest it in small chunks as opposed to say, like, you know, here, read these 8 novels that'll get you up to postmodern fiction. So it's good for that. And it's something that, you know, even if you're not a musician, myself included, you probably have familiarity with and opinions about, that kind of thing. So it's a nice access point. But rather than just sort of say, well, here, this is what postmodern music is, and give you a definition, what I'd like to do is do a series of broadcasts where I walk you through how we got here, sort of, so to speak, the rise of postmodern music. And so we're going to have to start at the beginning, because all movements, be they postmodernism or any other movement, modernism or existentialism or romanticism or transcendentalism, Dadaism, et cetera, are always reactions to what came before. That's part of what's going on, is that they're a reaction of some sort against or variation or, but they are very aware of the immediate preceding sort of cultural ambiance and way of thinking. The difference, I'll say it now and hope I remember it in a while, the difference with postmodernism is not only is it reacting, but it has more than any other movement a really keen awareness, not just of the most immediate preceding movement, modernism, but really of all movements. So there's a kind of historical awareness at work in postmodernism, where they're aware of it, but they don't value it. There's no valorization of what came before. So, it is to say, it's all treated equally. One, you know, whether it's Greek classicism or romanticism or modernism, it's all the same to them. So, but let's dive into and listen to our first piece of music. And these are going to be just really kind of short. I mean, 2 to 4 minutes long, these pieces. To give us just like a little sampler, a little taste of, if you were kind of wondering. Of course, you could do more exploring. I encourage that on your own. But we need to lay a kind of foundation for the rise of, certainly of modernism. And I'm going to smash together some 1,000 years of Western cultural history and music by introducing Bach. And the Bach I've chosen is the Bach's solo cello suites for solo cello performed by the great Yo-Yo Ma. I use Bach because A, he's great, but B, because I think these, and especially these cello suites, allow us to hear, to my limited understanding, because again, I'll say this again and again and again, a musicologist, a music kid, a music player, I am not. But you can hear when I listen to Bach, when I listen to Beethoven, Mozart, whoever you like, when I listen to them, what I hear largely is balance, right? Things just, it just feels balanced. And especially Yo-Yo Ma and these cello suites, it's balanced, it flows, it's supple. It's kind of like just running water flowing gently downstream. So we're going to listen to cello suite number 1 in G. It's recorded by Yo-Yo Ma. And we're going to listen for the balance of sound, timbre, pitch, rhythm, harmony, melody, the way these things are all kind of sync, the way they all kind of sync up and function together to bring out this really beautiful piece of music. So here we go, Bach cello suite number 1 in G. Okay, that was Bach. Next up, we're going to get a lot closer. In fact, we're going to get to the beginnings of modernism. We're going to listen to a piece by Eric Satie, European composer, French, kind of idiosyncratic. So the story goes, as an adult, he wore only velvet, and pretty much if he couldn't walk there, he didn't go there. So perhaps a man after my own heart. Satie, again, I picked Nosonines. My French kids will laugh at me and then maybe help me out. It's a solo piano piece. Pieces that he wrote in a style that he described as furniture music. Some people cite Satie as the father of ambient music. He wrote these pieces not to be front and center, but to provide background. And they do in a kind of really, but they're so beautiful, it's hard not to pay attention to them. There is less, a little bit less narrative, perhaps, a little bit less forward motion than we heard in the Bach piece. There is a little bit more, in a kind of structural way, repetition. Certain sequences are going to repeat themselves. But there is just a very sort of understated, yet beautiful quality to this. And so Satie begins, this is as good a place as any, to suggest to us that perhaps we need to listen differently, that we need to, retune our ears, especially this idea of furniture music, this idea of what should be front and center, or not front and center in this case. He didn't really think the orchestra should be. So Eric Satie, Nassim, number one.
Thank you.
So if Satie was sublime, then we need to strap ourselves in, because now we're going to listen to a piece by Igor Stravinsky from the Rite of Spring. This is called The Sacrifice. Stravinsky writes this piece 1911, 1912. It gets its first performance in 1913. And he's writing it for a ballet. He's already written two pieces for this ballet that have been incredibly well received. So Stravinsky's kind of at the height of his powers. And he writes this piece. And it is, if Bach and Satie had a kind of balance to them, this is a really different balance. It wasn't the balance the audience was expecting. It's loud, it's dissonant, it's discordant at parts. There is structure, it hangs, it's not noise, not by a long shot. It's very composed. But it was so perhaps different than what the audience thought they were going to get. So the story goes that on opening night, when it was performed, the people, the audience members, rioted. I just want you to pause for a second and think about this. This is not Lollapalooza, right? This is uptown, seated orchestra, ballet, right? As formal, you know, long gowns, pearls, tuxedos, top hats, and they rioted. It was so loud, so the story goes, that the composer could not hear the musicians, and it kind of fell apart. And Stravinsky fled backstage for fear, before it was over, for fear that he was going to be, you know, abused. So it really was upsetting, and it kind of, you know, if there has to be a marker, for this, the real beginning of modernism, 1913 is a pretty good year, well, with Marcel Duchamp's New Descending a Staircase and Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. So we get to hear, but again, I would encourage you to listen all the way through it, because there is composition to it. There is it's a different kind of balance. I wouldn't call it beautiful, but I would call it, you know, composed and smart and just, well, it's a really important piece of music. So, Igor Stravinsky, Rite of Spring, The Sacrifice. Thank you. Okay, next up on WTOK, we're coming to America. Scott Joplin. Written somewhere early 1900s, 1910s, the Maple Leaf Rag. Scott Joplin was a proponent and kind of a founder of a style of music, specifically piano playing, that came to be known as ragtime. Very syncopated, very rhythmic, very structured. But obviously, once you hear it, you realize it's music made for dancing. It's music made for good times. It comes out of the African-American musical traditions in the late 1800s, you know, where we're moving out of songs of the field, the slave, what are referred to as field hollers that the slaves would sing while they worked. We are moving into the very beginning, it's not quite there yet, of blues. Ragtime is a precursor to jazz. You know, you can hear that if you have some familiarity with early jazz, you'll hear the similarities. But it is a more popular music. And I think that is one of the shifts that begins to lay the groundwork, though it's, you know, some 80 years away, for postmodernism, is the ability to put popular music that was more for the masses than, say, Stravinsky, Satie, or Bach, to make it available. So two things are at work when we get to Joplin and the artist after that, and that is we got popular forms of music that are able to be popular precisely because of the technology, right? So recordings in the late 19-teens, 1920s, You're able to start making recordings, not vinyl LPs like you and I know. There are these little wax cylinders that are eventually in the 20s going to morph their way into what are called 78s, real thick. They look like records, like vinyl records, except they're only about 7 to 10 inches wide or in diameter, and they are very thick. They're about a quarter inch thick. It enabled the beginnings of a kind of mass production of music that is going to be a really significant portion of what's going to happen in postmodernism. But we got to start somewhere. And so Maple Leaf Rag with Scott Joplin, its syncopation, its rhythms, its pacing, you know, its reliance on a kind of dance or popular culture, I think it was an important shift in the history of music. So, without further ado, Maple Leaf Rag. Thank you. So if Joplin is sort of the precursor to jazz, Louis Armstrong, we have jazz full force. 1920s, 1930s, Louis Armstrong, young guy coming out of New Orleans, trumpet player, cornet player, really powerful, able to do things with the trumpet that hadn't been heard before. Some say he was so powerful that when he finally went into the recording studio, his horn was so loud they had to stand him 20 feet behind the rest of the band. He, of course, becomes a band leader right away, and he records his early sessions are with a group of five other musicians called Louis Armstrong and the Hot Fives, and then later he adds two more people, including an occasional vocalist who later became his wife, Minnie. And so it's Louis Armstrong and the Hot Sevens. So, and they record, probably about, well, this day and age, four CDs worth of music that it's kind of like the Ten Commandments of jazz. They're so important, these songs. Blues, ballads, dance pieces, all kinds of just experimentation, stuff that he'd performed. I mean, you know, this is the very beginnings of the recording industry, recording technology. So, you know, this is all stuff that he'd performed live for months, if not years, and just was taking it into the studio to make extra bucks on the side selling albums. So, you know, the record was not the primary focal point. So, but he goes in and he cuts these sides, and they just become so important. The kind of holy grail of jazz. So they lay a foundation for stylistically music, you know, musical styles, not just the style of jazz, but the other thing that Armstrong brings and kind of, in a sense, almost invents is the role of the soloist. They're not long solos, but you'll hear a trumpet solo and a cornet solo in the song we're going to listen to, which is one of my favorites. It's called Potato Head Blues. So you hear these short solos, and that's kind of innovative. The idea that a single person could step out and improvise against the backdrop was certainly not something you found in Bach or Satie, Stravinsky, right? That's not a classical hallmark. So this, you know, and perhaps we can make an argument about American individualism and that kind of thing, and I'll leave that to you. I'm not going to make it, but I'm going to ask you to sit back, and if you've never heard it, listen to it. Potato Head Blues, Louis Armstrong and his Hot Fives. Thank you. It is widely said and widely believed by scholars and fans that American, true American music, that America contributes two forms of music to the world. And they both get their starts in the early 20th century and take some pride in this young people in the South. And that would be jazz. And so we heard Louis Armstrong. That would be, you know, the origins of jazz, New Orleans. A lot of people say that's the place. I'm good with that. The other style of music would be the blues. Nowhere else in the world do you find the blues until America brings it to light, brings it to life. And we're going to start with the father of the blues, at least as far as recording goes. And again, here's the style of music that was invented probably late 1890s, early 1900s, and played widely throughout the South. Saturday night juke joints, and pool halls, and bars, and brothels, and on doorsteps. You know, just not feeling it. You got the blues. But it takes until the late 1920s, early 1930s for any blues to actually be recorded that we sort of think of as blues today. And some of the first recordings are made by the man who is largely seen as the father of the blues, and that would be Robert Johnson. Robert Johnson was born to field workers in Mississippi. You know, scrabble, hard luck life, childhood. Teenager, has a talent for music, but doesn't seem to be anything special. Gets guitar, gets some training from some distant relatives, and then disappears. Kind of tries to, you know, young teen, you know, 17, 18, tries to make a living as an entertainer rather than a field hand, and kind of disappears for about 6 to 8 months. And when he comes back, he's amazing. He's just blowing people away. He's such a transformation. And so the story is told that Robert Johnson and the devil made a deal down at the crossroads at midnight. And that the story is that Johnson sold his soul to the devil in exchange for talent, in exchange for this musical gift. It's a nice legend. I don't know. I mean, you know, it permeates blues and rock culture, selling your soul to the devil, songs about it, that kind of thing. But he is unlike most other blues musicians of the time. He records not many tracks in a hotel room. There are no recording studios in Mississippi. And shortly after recording them, he dies. He's actually killed in a fight over a woman. Apparently he was fooling around with somebody else's girl. The boyfriend didn't like it and put about a quart of lye down his throat, which did him in. So we only have this small handful of sides, but you know, it's again, template for the blues, template for American music, template for rock and roll. You know, to this day, people are still paying attention to, listening to the legend and the music of Robert Johnson. And so now you will too. The song we're going to hear is a classic, If I Had Possession Over Judgment Day, full of sorrow, hard luck, and a little bit of the occult. So, enjoy.
Any woman I'm loving wouldn't have about the way they treated me.
WTOK, Radio Whiteside, back in the backyard. I'm kind of grooving on this. I like this. There's something kind of cagey about this, right? Making a radio broadcast with the sounds of life around you. Maybe we call it the music of life. So I'm kind of grooving on this. We got birds. We got East Boulevard traffic. We got all kinds of sounds. Watching the trees grow. You know, it's a good place. Next up. So we get jazz and blues born in America. And in the 1920s, they start to take off. And real popular, you know, and the whole experience, exposure, and discussions, looking at race relations, because of course jazz and blues, both African American musical traditions, you know, but adapted, co-opted, appropriated by white audiences, you know, white kids sneaking out, going to gin joints on Saturday night, you know, to listen to the blues musicians, jazz musicians, just this kind of crossover, and yet, you know, a certain sort of really, you know, maybe in some places virulent strains of racism still a lot, you know, in control. So the 20s and 30s, musically, artistically, you know, the effect on race and race relations is just really fascinating and worth several studies. So I'll just point you in that direction. Actually, a little promo. You can hear a little bit of that in a... I put together a much earlier broadcast from my teaching career, A History of Southern Rock, which found it on my hard drive over the weekend. So I'll try to make that available in some way, shape, or form. Therein I talk a little bit more about race, and you can hear it a little bit more acutely. But nonetheless, for our purposes, what we're going to hear now is a piece of music that I really love, but it is very much a kind of whitewashing of sorts, to use that in the least pejorative way possible, but nonetheless to draw attention to it, of certain blues and jazz styles. George Gershwin, great composer, you know, and is people like Gershwin and Paul Whiteman and composers of the 20s and 30s, I call them composers, but they bridge a kind of gap that that we seem to have in America more so at that time than other places, that is between the classical world and the popular world. And they take what, you know, edges of the popular, edges of what's maybe sketchier, jazz and blues, ragtime, and they try to make it more palatable for the, say, a higher rent district, the paying audiences. And so, you know, but in doing so, some really great and really important music is made. And that's the piece I'm going to play for you today. I'm not going to play the whole thing. It's called Rhapsody in Blue. It's meant for kind of a small orchestra. And it is, you can hear, if you've had a little bit more exposure than, say, Joplin and Armstrong to jazz, you'll be able, but even if that's it, you'll be able to hear the jazz elements in it. But you'll also get that kind of balanced feel that we got with Satie and Bach. You know, that there's a kind of flow to it that is, there's rhythm, but it's not as dominant as what we've heard, you know, coming out of Robert Johnson or Scott Joplin. So, Rhapsody in Blue. We're going to listen to a three-minute excerpt from it. The whole piece itself usually runs about, if I remember correctly, like about 10 minutes. It's worth finding. It's really great, really wonderful piece. So, here, this would have been something that, you know, your parents probably wouldn't have let you listen to Robert Johnson. So maybe that would have been impetus to go find him in the 1930s. But they certainly would have been happy if you'd been listening to Rhapsody in Blue. So here we are, WTOK Radio Whiteside with Rhapsody in Blue. Okay, WTOK, Radio Whiteside, we're back. So, George Gershwin and his orchestra, or sometimes it's referred to the George Gershwin Big Band, play in a kind of this kind of lush style that is, you know, some people would argue made mainly for white audiences. And what he is doing is he's the argument would run that he's borrowing or co-opting from African-American traditions. Jazz, which starts with, you know, if we started with Louis Armstrong and his Hot Fives and Hot Sevens, you know, it's a band, five, six, seven guys, people. But some of the jazz musicians begin to say, well, there are other instruments. We have more access. And of course, when jazz gets popular, it starts to make its way into dance clubs. And you want a fuller sound. We don't have electronic amplification yet. We're not, you know, you can't run all the instruments through mics. You can't mic everything. And so a bigger ensemble will provide a bigger sound. So if Gershwin is made for and is composing for the concert hall, what's it sound like in the dance clubs? What's it sound like in, you know, the speakeasies? And there you're going to get jazz big bands. People like Count Basie, Fletcher Henderson. But the preeminent and a premier jazz big band, of course, is going to be Duke Ellington. From roughly 1938 to 1944 is really great years with Jimmy Blanton and Ben Webster. You know, so it's about a 16 to 22 piece band. And they are, of course, by this point in time, have figured out the recording studio, and so they're making use of recording studio. They're performing live everywhere. They are, you know, they're, and musically, in American culture at this time, they're a force to be reckoned with. So, you know, Ellington really sets the template for jazz composition going forward in musical history, and is an innovator and artist in his own right. So great, great cuts. And, you know, again, fortunately, because of the recording studio, there's plenty of Ellington to be found. So if you like this, you can find a ton of it, you know, in a variety of places. So the Ellington piece we're going to listen to, and you really can go no wrong between 38 and 44. We're going to pick one of his more famous pieces. It's called Take the A Train. Kind of a trying to paint a picture of big city life, taking the A train into New York City. So there's that kind of propulsive rhythm, but in a kind of really maybe say smoother or lusher style than Joplin, but still you can hear the dance in it, you can hear the rhythm, and you can hear a, now this is a new kind of balancing of harmony and melody, pitch, timbre, of these kinds of elements of music, right? It's the roughness of Joplin has been polished over, the rawness of Armstrong has been smoothed out a little bit, but yet there is, I don't know if I'd say edgy, but there is something exciting about it. So it's exciting music. So I give you Duke Ellington and Take the A Train on WTOK. So we've made our way from essentially the 1700s all the way up to the start of World War II musically. And what we've done is we've laid down the foundation for the transition from what we would call classical music today to more popular forms of music. We've seen a subtle shift in, especially in American music, more oriented around rhythm, more structured for, I don't say dance or entertainment, but that has been a major rise, aided and abetted by the rise of technologies that have allowed for that to happen, encouraged that to happen. We've seen a shift in emphasis away from the orchestra, with the composer and or conductor as the star, to the individual as the star, Scott Joplin, Louis Armstrong, Robert Johnson. So we have seen this, I hesitate to call it a pure rise in individualism, but certainly room for the individual artist, so to speak, to shine. And so we have, you know, with the rise of consumer, popular consumption of music, with the rise of larger role for the individual, rise of music as popular entertainment for the masses, we're laying the groundwork for, real solid groundwork, for the rise of what's going to become postmodernist music. So I hope you enjoyed this first foray into it. I'm going to start shut down now, edit, and work on part two, WTOK, Radio Whiteside, coming to you this spring 2020. Stay safe, y'all.